All right, nobody's in.
Except me.
Except you.
First home number 611, 611. Walking in sunlight, followed my journey over the mountains through the deep vale. Jesus has said, I'll never forsake thee. Promise divine that never can fail. Heavenly sunlight, heavenly sunlight, flooding my soul.
Where thou hast
Father, we thank you for the opportunity we have here to have fellowship with you and with one another. We pray that as we sing praises to you and worship you, that we do so with a heart and mind focused on you. Father, we pray for those that are sick, for Rebecca's dead. We pray for Benny and his loss and all those that are suffering. Father, we ask you to bring comfort and we ask you to bring comfort to them and to their loved ones. We thank you for all your blessings, and it's in Jesus' name we pray.
Go ahead and mark your song, folks. Number 791, 791 will be song after the lesson. Song before the lesson, number 716, 716. Mark number 791, and we'll sing number 716.
Sing to me a heaven, sing that song of peace. From the toils that by me it will bring release. Burdens will be lifted that are pressing so. Showers of great blessing o'er my heart will flow. Sing to me a heaven, let me find me walking dream.
First reads, the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? Can everybody hear me okay? I just realize I don't have my microphone on. The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? So the question is, Jesus, you know, it talks about the cup that we bless, and Jesus blessed the cup. Does that mean we have to use only one cup when we have communion? Well, I'll tell you right now, you already know what my answer is going to be. Otherwise, I would have said something a couple hours ago. Hey, we're not doing this right. All right, so let's look at the context around 1 Corinthians 10. All right. So that says, the cup of blessing which we bless. All right, who is this being addressed to? I'll give you a hint, it's 1 Corinthians.
Corinthian Christians.
Yeah. All right. Paul is saying, the cup which we bless. Where was Paul when he wrote these things? Not the other one yet. This was an Ephesus. But even if it wasn't, the same point would be there. Writing from Ephesus to the Christians in Corinth, was there just one container that was being used by Paul and the Corinthians? Because that would mean first thing Sunday morning, these guys need to drink it, and then they need to like get on horseback and take it to the next congregation. Today, okay, you have to get like an ocean liner full of grape juice at the international date line and get things going. Everybody's got to drink from that one container before the day runs out. Okay. You know how I am with numbers. All right. How many people were added to the church on Pentecost?
3,000.
About 3,000. So, how many people would you expect to be gathered together the following Sunday?
3,000.
Yeah. All right. So, if they used only one container on that Sunday, for what?
Big cup.
Yeah. Well, how big? If everybody took a tablespoon, it would have required a container nearly 12 gallons, weighing about 90 pounds, and if it got passed every 15 seconds to the next person, it would have taken 12 and a half hours for the first half of the Lord's Supper. Does that seem like something reasonable? Here's something else. The Lord's Supper was instituted at the Passover meal. You know, Jesus gathered with the apostles for Passover. And Paul here refers, in 1 Corinthians, refers to the cup of blessing. Well, the cup of blessing was the fourth cup used in the Passover meal. There was a cup of sorrows and a cup of, and I can't remember what the other one was. Cup of blessing was number four. So even the very first Lord's Supper didn't have just one cup. I had a friend who was a missionary to England. He was a native, came to America, and he took mission trips there probably about every 6 or 9 months until he died. He told me about how the one cup movement took hold over there. You know how we've been using two trays for the Lord's Supper, and you know, a little while back we're using four of them. That's the way things were at most of the congregations over there. They would use two cups or four cups, depending on how big the congregations were. Well, one day, people just up and bought the little individual cups and put those out instead of the two or four big cups they had been using. Well, some people got so upset that they replaced their four cups with 60 little ones, that they looked for a way to get rid of the 60 little ones, and they said, okay, well, if we take this, then we got to use one now, which means what they were doing was just as wrong according to their logic, but they wanted it so bad they were willing to go against what they really wanted, that's something closer to it. Like a lot of other things, if a congregation chooses to use one cup, but they don't say, you have to, that's fine, that's their business. Sit in the front row ahead and stop tippers. But when somebody says, you have to do it this way, it's wrong, it's sinful to do it any other way, they've got to give you book, chapter, and verse, and they're not going to fine you for that. Anything else over the one cup thing? All right. Next question. How can Jesus be both advocate and judge? Isn't that a conflict of interest? All right. 1 John 2:1. Says, my little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. That word advocate used there, that's modern terminology. It's like defense attorney. Somebody standing there with you on your behalf, pleading your case. However, 2 Timothy 4:1, that I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. So it refers to Jesus there as judge. Well, what's the difference between the two passages? Okay, it does seem kind of strange, the idea of Jesus judging and defending, but you've got two different time periods described there. He is our advocate, you know, our defender now. He's there pleading our case now before the Father. But at the day of judgment, he's going to be the judge then. About anybody who is a judge, you don't start out as a judge. Usually you're a defender for a while, well, sometimes lawyer, and then you move up to that position. Not like Jesus needed a promotion as much as the same way, there's no conflict there. He's a defender at one time and a judge at a different time. Okay, the denomination world speaks of witnessing when they evangelize, and this is terminology is being used in the church more and more. Is it right to use this term? Well, What is a witness?
Someone who saw something, who has information about something.
Yeah. They saw something. It's firsthand knowledge, something they saw or heard themselves. Okay, Acts 22:15. Speaking to Paul, like Paul recalling what was said to him, for thou shalt be his witness unto all men of what thou hast seen and heard. Acts 26:16. The words of Jesus, but rise and but stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of the things which thou hast seen and of those things in the which I will appear unto thee. What happens if somebody goes to court? All right, what are you here for? Well, I'm a witness. What did you see? Well, I didn't see anything. I wasn't there at the time. What's the judge going to say?
Sit down in my courtroom.
Sit down or get out or go. Because you can't be a witness to something you haven't seen. You can relate those things, and we will not even touch on the rules of hearsay. That is the part of law school people hate most. The gospel writers were witnesses. They were there. They saw what Jesus did. They heard what he said. Lots and lots and lots of passages referring to them as witnesses. Luke 24:48, ye are witnesses of these things. Acts 1:8, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. All speaking to the apostles. Acts 3:15, killed the Prince of Life whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. Now, Acts 10:41. Not to all the people, but unto witnesses chosen before God, even to us who did eat and drink with them after he rose from the dead. Notice that says not everybody is a witness. Not even at that time was everybody a witness. I think the idea comes from the idea that when you're speaking to somebody about the gospel, you talk about yourself. Well, you know, I used to be this low-down, no-good worm. But then Jesus came into my life, and now, you know, I've seen these things, I've done these things. But that's all subjective. How do they know what you used to be? Maybe you're exaggerating. How do they know what you are now? It's real easy for people to take anything as being some kind of sign of God's favor. Stories told about a guy who was up preaching. And he said, God called me to be a preacher because I looked up at the clouds one day and one looked like a G and a P and a C. And I knew that meant go preach Christ. And he went and preached for a while. Sat down. Somebody went up to him later and said, I think GPC means go pick cotton. When we're trying to tell somebody how to get to heaven, what is the one absolutely positive, sure thing that we have that will direct them to heaven?
Bible.
The Bible. Matthew 26:59. Not the right. Okay. I'm going to have to real quick find that again because I made a typo in my notes. The use of the word right before the one I quoted. Matthew 24:14 says, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come." So, the witness that needs to speak today is not us talking about what we felt, what we saw. The gospel is witness, let the Bible speak. Point to people what the Bible said and not your conversion experience, whatever that means. I've had people asking me, what was your conversion? I said, I did what the Bible said to do, and here's what the Bible says to do. Because the Bible's right, that's the one thing we know absolutely positively is right. So let's look there. Anybody have any other questions for me? Because they went a little quicker than I expected.
Okay, how does that vary with the words testimony? I want to give my testimony, because that's all I heard this last semester,
right,
was testimony.
It's the exact same thing. A testimony is what a witness says. All right, the meaning of the word testimony, without going too deep into, is like a sworn statement. Goes back to the swearing, in Latin, that they would swear that this is, well, what is it that, first of all, who should testify? A witness. But what should be testified? What that person heard saw. And there is so much emphasis on self and how things feel. How many people have ever been absolutely, positively sure you were right, and it turns out you were wrong? You can't use your feelings to judge right or wrong. You got to go by something objective, something unchanging, something unmoving. That's the Bible. All right. So, with that being said, we need to go by the Bible. If there's anything that anybody needs to do to change their lives to match the unchanging Bible, take the opportunity. And if there's anything we can do to help, come forward and dance and sing songs of encouragement.
On bended knee I come, with a humble heart I come, bowing down.
77. Now I ask Shay to lead us in our closing prayer. 77.
Father, we love you, we worship and adore you. Glorify thy name in all the earth. Glorify thy name. Glorify thy name. Glorify thy name in all the earth. Jesus, we love you, we worship and adore you. Glorify thy name in all the earth. Glorify thy name. Glorify thy name. Glorify thy name in all the earth.
Let's pray. Thank you, O Lord, for this opportunity you've given to us to come together, to sing praise to you, and to learn your word, to teach it to the world around us. Please watch over us as we depart from this place of worship, that we may come together again at the next point in time to once again learn of your word and sing praises to you. Bless your son's name. Amen.